Welcome. Let's look at the cervical fascia and the cervical compartments. After watching this lecture video, we should be able to define what the cervical fascia is, the layers of the cervical fascia, the cervical compartments, the anatomical spaces that this fascia form, and also clinical application. The cervical fascia versus the cervical compartment. The cervical fascia is actually responsible for dividing the cervical region into the compartments that they are made up of. The cervical fascia is a sheet of connective fibrous tissue that is primarily made up of collagen fibers. The pattern by which they divide the cervical compartment is along its longitudinal plane. So they tend to divide it vertically. So let's say this is the entire cervical region. We now have the fascia dividing it into compartments. So it tends to compartmentalize the cervical region. So there is a longitudinal compartment that the cervical fascia creates and it's called the cervical compartment. So let's follow with this lecture to see how this is presented. So we have the cervical fascia. We'll be studying the cervical fascia using the transverse section of the neck. Let's assume this is the neck and downward we have the shoulder. When you take a transverse section or a cut along the horizontal plane, we have this kind of presentation. So this is what we'll be using as our basis for studying the cervical fascia and the cervical compartments. The cervical fascia are broadly divided into two. We have the superficial fascia, which is a fascia that is located below the skin. So let's say that we have the skin being removed or being taken off. So the layer deep to it is the superficial fascia. This area dotted is the superficial cervical fascia, which is seen in the most outer region below the skin. Then we have the deep cervical fascia. The deep cervical fascia, from the name, they are located deep to the superficial cervical fascia. So this is the superficial, and any fascia that is seen deep to it is called the deep cervical fascia. The deep cervical fascia is also referred to as the fascia coli in old tests. Let's look at the pattern by which the superficial cervical fascia and the deep cervical fascia run. So for the superficial cervical fascia, we already said that it is located deep to the skin. And this fascia contains a superficial muscle that is called the platysmal muscle. This platysmal muscle is seen in the superficial region of the neck, and it runs from the lower part of the mandible down to overlap onto the upper part of the shoulder, and is a very thin muscle that is seen within the superficial fascia. So this is the platysmal muscle highlighted in blue, embedded within the superficial cervical fascia. So apart from the superficial cervical fascia giving an outer covering to the neck, they also provide sides onto which the platysmal muscle is embedded. Going to the deep fascia, the deep cervical fascia has a very complex pattern by which they run. They are not just seen lining deep to the superficial fascia. They undergo some form of complexity within the cervical region. Remember when we started with this lecture, we said that the cervical fascia helps to compartmentalize the neck. The specific layer of the cervical fascia that is responsible for this is the deep cervical fascia. So let us see how the deep cervical fascia is able to divide the cervical region into compartments. The cervical fascia is further subdivided into a number of fascia, and these fascia are being determined by what they enclose or what they surround. So the first one is the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. From the name investing, it means it invests muscle. And this is the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. It is highlighted in red. And this is the way it runs. It is deep because it is located deep to the superficial cervical fascia. We say it's investing because it's invest muscle. Remember that in the four angles of the neck, in the anterior part, we have the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So this is sternocleidomastoid muscle on one side. This is sternocleidomastoid muscle on the other side. Then posteriorly, we have the trapezius. So this is the trapezius muscle on one side, and this is the trapezius muscle on the other side. So what the investing layer of this cervical fascia does is that it invests the sternocleidomastoid. After investing it, at the terminal end of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, it merges to become one, and it runs a short course before it opens up again to invest the trapezius muscle. At this terminal head, it closes and merges to become one and run a short distance before it opens up again to receive the trapezius on the other side. At the anterior end of the trapezius, it merges again to become one. It runs a short distance to meet with the sternocleidomastoid muscle on the other side. It opens up, it invests the sternocleidomastoid muscle and closes up again to become one. And that is how they run. Because of the way they run, they are able to form posterior attachment with the vertebral column. You can see it at the back. They form a connection with the vertebral bone. Then anteriorly, this is the hyoid bone. The hyoid bone is found at the roof of the neck. They connect anteriorly with the hyoid bone. This is just to help keep the investing layer in place so as to prevent folding. Also to add that cutaneous branches of the cervical plexus pierces the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. The cervical plexus are formed from the cervical spinal nerve around this space, and they run to pierce the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia so as to have access to the skin of the cervical region. And also, we have the posterior triangle around this space between the sternocleidomastoid muscle anteriorly and the trapezius muscle posteriorly. Then the next layer of the deep cervical fascia is the pretracheal fascia. From the name pretracheal fascia, it means they enclose the trachea and the surrounding structure. So this is the trachea, this is the serine cartilage, and this is the trachealis muscle at the back that helps to fill up the open space that is formed by the serine cartilage. Anterior to that, we have the thyroid gland. Then posteriorly, of course, we know we have the parathyroid gland. Posterior to the trachea, we have the esophagus. So we have the pretracheal fascia enclosing the entire surface of the trachea and the surrounding structure. And this is the pretracheal fascia. Also, at the posterior end of the pretracheal fascia, we have a specialized type of fascia that is formed from the pretracheal fascia, and that is the buccopharyngeal fascia. This buccopharyngeal fascia encloses the pharyngeous muscle, and you see as a posterior continuation of the pretracheal fascia. Then the next fascia is the prevertebral fascia. The prevertebral, from the name, it means it encloses the vertebral bone and the surrounding muscle. This is the vertebral bone, and you have muscles around it. You see it surrounding the vertebral bone and the associated muscle. And this is the prevertebral fascia. Another specification that the prevertebral fascia gives is in the anterior part. We say that it runs around the vertebral column and the associated muscle. When it gets to this point, there is a doubling of its anterior layer. And you see it, it's divided into two. So we have a subset kind of in the anterior part as it runs, covering the anterior region of the vertebral bone and the associated muscle, dividing into two layers. So we have the prevertebral fascia. Then we have another fascia on top that's called the alar fascia. So the alar fascia is like a subset of the prevertebral fascia. So you can see the kind of specification that this fascia gives. Even around the process of compartmentalizing the cervical region, they still have some form of specification as they run through. These are the three basic fascia that we have in the neck. We also have some other fascia that will be highlighting. We also have other fascia, which include the carotid sheet. This is the carotid sheet. It's a sheet that helps to enclose the vascular compartment of the neck. We have the internal jugular vein laterally. We have the common carotid medially to the internal jugular vein. Then we have the vagus nerve located posteriorly between the two. So this is how they are placed within the carotid sheet. This carotid sheet is formed from the three fascias that we talked about initially. So the lateral part of the carotid sheet is formed by the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. So this region is formed by the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. Then this layer around the region of the vertebral bone is formed by the prevertebral fascia. Then the anterior part is formed by the pretracheal fascia of the deep cervical fascia. So this carotid sheet is formed by the fascia that surround it. The next one is the fascia that encloses the infrahyoid muscle. Superficial to the pretracheal fascia, we have infrahyoid muscle, which are muscles that are located below the hyoid bone. So this muscle also are enclosed by fascia. And this is the fascia, and it is termed the fascia of the infrahyoid muscle. This fascia is believed to have been formed from the pretracheal fascia, Why some tests would say that it is formed from the investing fascia. So let's look at the cervical compartment. We haven't discussed the cervical fascia. So let's see how these fascia are able to form different compartments within the cervical region. So the first one is the visceral compartment. And this is the visceral compartment. From the name, it is the region where we see the viscera of the neck, which include the thyroid gland, the trachea, the esophagus, and also some other structure. Then we have the next one, the vascular compartment, which means the compartment that is filled with vessels. And this is the vascular compartment. These vascular compartments are paired. So we have one on the right and the other on the left. So we have the carotid sheet enclosing this compartment. Then the last one is the vertebral compartment, which is the vertebral bone and the associated muscle. So this is the vertebral compartment. So you can see how the fascia have been able to compartmentalize the neck into different regions. The anatomical spaces. Also, these fascia have formed anatomical spaces within the cervical region. And these anatomical spaces are of great clinical importance. The first one we will look at is the retropharyngeal space. From the name retro, it means behind the pharynx. So this is the retropharyngeal space between the bucopharyngeal membrane and the alar fascia. Remember, we talked about the alar fascia being a subset of the prevertebral fascia. So this is the alar fascia, and this is the bucopharyngeal membrane, which is the posterior extension of the pretracheal fascia. So this space is where we refer to as the retropharyngeal space. This space may tend to bulge or increase due to infection. And when it does this, because we have the trachea, we have the esophagus, when this space bulges, definitely the function that the organ located within the visceral compartment of the neck will be affected. So swallowing and breathing will be affected because of the bulginess of this space. And this can occur as a result of infection. This is the retropharyngeal space. Then another anatomical space is a potential space that is created between the prevertebral fascia and also the alar fascia. Remember, we said that this is the alar fascia and this is the prevertebral fascia. And this space is called the danger space. So this region is termed the danger space because infection can spread from the lower part of the skull down to the thoracic region because this space links these two regions together. Then clinical application. We now know that the cervical fascia compartmentalizes the neck, and this is relevant in surgery and also radiology, so that the specialists will be able to know where to target when they want to perform surgical operation on different viscera. It also helps to limit the spread of diseases because we say they are surrounded or enclosed by the cervical fascia. When there's an infection within a compartment, it will be restricted within that space. There will not be a spread. So it will help to limit the rate at which they will spread to other compartments. It also helps to guide and allow easy movement of viscera and also muscles against each other. The visceral compartment and the vertebral compartment are able to slide over each other freely because of the formation that the cervical fascia has created. We can check our understanding of this lecture with the following question. We can describe the divisions of the cervical region into compartments by the cervical fascia. We can also describe the anatomical spaces created by the deep cervical fascia. All these have been well highlighted in this lecture. So thank you for watching. Let's meet again.